sale is coming up. That is the first weekend in September?
Last weekend of August, I think. Last weekend of August.
Last weekend of August is the yard sale. If you have items that you wish to donate for that yard sale, and then those things will be put out, displayed, and so forth, and then they'll be taken care of that weekend. If you have any questions on that, was it Laquita? Was Laquita heading that up this year? Somebody help me out. Denny Hedges, will you do me a favor? Or Charlie, you're standing back there. Laquita, wait. Were you heading up yard sale? Who was taking care of yard sale?
If they have any questions, want to donate anything, get a hold of me, I'll take care of it.
There you go. Charlie's taking care of the yard sale. And so if you have any questions regarding that or items that you need to put out, because I do see Charlie, and we'll clear those away. Also, we have our annual election. If you have nominations or suggestions to our nominating committee, there's a fellow back there with a plaid shirt on. He is the chair of the nominating committee. Today is the last day for nominations. And then those folks will be considered, and we will go on from there. Are there other announcements that I have not made? Youth Fair starts, it's a week from Friday when we need folks, correct, Matt?
Correct.
And all that list has already been composed.
We already started handing out the pass.
There you go, okay.
And produce, like outside.
There is produce on the front porch, available for your eating. I would not suggest you go out there and belly up to the trough like a hog, but if you took it by hand and took it home, and then you get out of there.
And we have no problem with someone taking the zucchini home, making bread, and bring it back next week.
There you go. Good suggestion, Charlie. Okay, other announcements that I've not been given. Okay, prayer list. Please add the name of Janet Schultz to that prayer list, the family of Janet Schultz. And also the name of Carrie Baker and Humpty Dumpty Bishop on the back pew. Her words, not mine. She had a great fall, but she didn't break anything, but she is a little worse for wear. So again, Marlene Bishop fell. Darcy Daly went back to the hospital, if I understand correctly, with seizures.
Yes.
And so keep him in your prayers. Alexis Early already on your prayer list, had a rather severe vehicle accident and will be undergoing treatment for that. Larry Dale Briggs is out of ICU. And also Mike Hopkins, add him to your list, or he's on your list, keep him. Those are the ones that I had that were mentioned. Are there others for our prayer list that I have not been given? Wave a hand and yes, Bob.
I'd just like to thank everyone for the prayers and concerns for them, his brother that passed away. And he was on our continued prayer list for a couple of years, so he had a long struggle and finally gave it up.
Okay, that was Larry Kerr. And did you say, if you know the family, then you can talk to Bob regarding that. And thank you, Bob. Any others that I have not been given? Yes, Susan.
David Statler.
David Statler.
He's in the hospital.
Okay. Connie's husband?
Yes.
Okay. Any others? Okay. All right. I've chosen a passage of scripture this morning. We've been studying some of this in Sunday school. And so my scripture is taken from Exodus chapter 20, starting with verse 1, 2, and 3. And God spoke all these words, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. Consider that when you're considering your activities and the things that you participate in on a day-to-day basis. Sometimes I think we all have gods before us. remain seated if you would, and we'll have a word of prayer, and then we'll proceed with our service. Let's pray with you. Father in heaven, thank you for this gorgeous day that you have given us. Please bless the activities of this congregation throughout the day. Bless our upcoming election. May those that are selected be willing to serve and serve and glorify you, not themselves. Lord, we thank you for everything that you've given us and continue to bless us with. We're not worthy of it, and please pray, bless those that we have mentioned on our prayers. Some of them we know very well, some of them we don't know very well, but again, they're all members of the human race and friends and family of ours, and please bless them. Now bless our service this morning, and continue to forgive us and we fear. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Lots of love, so a big, big table. With lots and lots of food. A big, big yard. Where we can play football. A big, big house. It's my father's house. A big, big house. With lots and lots of room. A big, big table. With lots and lots of. honest, it was like 20 years. I didn't realize that it had been so long since I'd been to camp. It's tiresome. I think I'm just now feeling back to normal. So, but it's fun. It's good for the kids, and Brooke's already ready for next year. So.
Thank you. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Anguish.
sight of him in glory. And what did Jesus say? You know not what you ask. Can you drink the cup that I drink? Can you be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with? He wasn't talking about water baptism with a cup of wine. He was talking about wrath, punishment, and judgment. In Luke 12:49, he says, I have come to bring fire on the earth. How I wish it were already kindled, but I have a baptism to undergo, and how distressed I am until it is completed. Again, not a water baptism. He knew what he was facing. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he says, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. And you're all familiar with the fact that three times, not once, but three times, he said, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, but not my will, your will. And then lastly, on the cross, he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Forsaken means abandoned. There's the anguish, there's the pain I feel that Christ was feeling in anticipation of this death. And I was kind of compelled to share this morning because I found myself in my daily prayers, even coming to the table each Sunday, you know, thanking God for dying for my sins. But that word dying was losing some meaning to me. I had to rediscover that. And when I did, was reading through this, I actually cried. And we're not going to do that each and every time we thank him for dying for our sins. But when you can appreciate what he endured for us, you know what you start to appreciate? His mercy and his grace and how great it is. And I'm so thankful for that. And, you know, we're going to come and take the bread and the cup, and we usually don't do this either, but again, I'm compelled that, you know, God, Christ tells us he's going to come again, and we're to partake of this till he comes again, and when he comes again, there is going to be fire, there is going to be wrath, and if you're outside of Christ, you're going to have the weeping and gnashing of teeth. If you're outside of Christ, even now, we ask that you come to know him, so you can join us at this table and appreciate the mercy, the love, and the grace that is extended to us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we are just so thankful that you give us your word. More importantly, that you gave us your son. That he did come from glory, and he bore the brunt of your wrath in our stead. Father, help us to appreciate that as we partake of these simple items of bread and the juice that represent both your body and blood. Help us to recognize just how great your mercy, love, and grace is towards us. Thank you for loving us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
There are times when God makes it clear to you what he wants you to preach on. He gives you a specific topic. I believe with all my heart and all my soul, today is such a day. Before we begin, we're going to start with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you are holy, holy, holy. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the sacrifice, God, for our sins. Please forgive us, God, of our sins. Fill us and lead us, Lord God, with and by your Holy Spirit. Direct our steps, God. God, I pray that there will be repentance and people being restored to you. And each of us individually and our families and the church body getting healthier, spiritually healthier. God, in Jesus' name, amen. The subject that God has placed on my heart today is sin. Now, what is sin? Vine's Dictionary defines sin as missing the mark. But that definition falls woefully short. It is the breaking of God's spiritual laws. The best definition for sin is in the scriptures in 1 John 3:4. Sin is lawlessness. Lawlessness against God and God's law. The first sin was Satan's pride. He tried to overthrow God, but he was thrown out of heaven. The first sin on earth was committed by Satan as well, when he lied to Eve. The first sin of a person was by Eve when she ate the fruit that she was commanded not to eat. Then Adam also later sinned as well, when he too ate the fruit that he too was commanded not to eat. You may be shocked to hear this. You may be shocked to hear this because it's a dominant teaching of today. You'll find it in virtually every commentary, almost every commentary that's out there today. And it's the concept of original sin. And it's basically this. You know, we just can't help ourselves because Adam sinned and so poor us. We're just going to sin. We don't have a choice. That is a lie from the devil. It is a lie from the devil. It's nothing more than a sorry attempt or excuse for our current or ongoing sinful behavior. Such concepts are not from God, but from the evil one. The concept of original sin is nothing more than a lie, an attempt to blame Adam for our own wicked, sinful, ongoing behavior. Do we suffer the consequences of Adam's sin? Well, yes, in one sense, they were kicked out of the garden, death entered the world, childbearing became much more difficult, the ground and creation were cursed. But are we personally held accountable for Adam's individual sin? No. It's basically the same excuse that Adam and Eve gave after they ate the fruit. Now compare these. Compare original sin to Adam and Eve's discussions with God. Okay? When it came time for spiritual accountability, where did God start first? Where did God start first? When it was time for accountability, where did God start first? He started with Adam, okay, the man of the house. Genesis 3:9. Now this is after Adam has already eaten the fruit that he was commanded not to. It says, "But the Lord God called to the man, 'Where are you?'" This is Genesis 3:10. He answered, I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And God said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" Verse 12, note this. What does Adam say? The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it." Now, what have we been taught pretty much all of our lives? We've been taught that Adam blamed who? Eve, right? We've been taught that our whole life. Look at this passage very closely. Let's look at it again, verse 12. The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it." Who is Adam truly blaming first? Adam's blaming God. Shockingly, he's actually blaming God. The woman you put here, then he's blaming Eve. It just goes to show that even if you study the scriptures all your life, that if you spend time studying them more and with an open heart, you'll continue to learn. Now, Eve says in Genesis 3:13, "Then the Lord God said to the woman, 'What is this that you have done?'" Referring to the fruit that she was commanded not to eat. "The woman said, 'The serpent deceived me, and I ate it.'" What is that? Bob already said it. What is that? Passing the buck. Right? Passing the buck. Trying to blame someone else for our own sins. And it's continuing to happen today, and it'll continue to happen all the way until Jesus returns. The concept of original sin, that is, poor us. Adam sinned. So therefore, all of us are just going to sin. We just can't help ourselves. Poor us. What can we do? How does that sound compared to what Adam and Eve said? It's the same thing. It's an excuse. It's a lie. An excuse. Now, how can we prove that this is a lie, the concept of original sin? How can we prove that the concept of original sin is a lie? What did our Lord Jesus say in Matthew 18, verses 2 and 3? Jesus is rebuking his disciples because of their sinful pride, which is usually first sin, honestly, right? Well, I know better than you, you little peon. Who do you think that you are? That's the idea, that's the concept. It's pride, it's ego. And when you're not followed, when you're not being led by the Holy Spirit, you're not being led by the Scriptures, that's what people default to. So, Jesus is rebuking the disciples for their sinful pride. Jesus says, "You must become like little children to enter the kingdom of heaven." Verse 2, "He called a little child and had him stand among them. And he said, 'I tell you the truth. I tell you the truth. Unless you change and become like this little, unless you become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven.'" What was the disciples' problem? Sinful pride, attitude. What did Jesus say? "You must change and become like little children, or you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Can Jesus make it any more clear than that? This is going to blow your minds. But what does Jesus not say in that passage? Or at least he doesn't say it at this time. He did not say, "These little children, they need to be baptized first because they're just pagan little immoral little sinners." Jesus didn't say that, did he? No. He said, "Unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." So what in the world does this mean? Jesus would never want us to become like little sinners, or big sinners, or any sinners, right? Jesus hates sin. He died to set us free from sin. Yet Jesus holds up these little children as a spiritual example of what his followers must become like in order to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Why? Why did Jesus do this? Because the truth is, our Lord Jesus, God the Father, the Holy Spirit, they see little children not as little sinners. They are innocent in the eyes of God. Otherwise, our Lord Jesus would not hold them up as a spiritual example of how to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, that blows up the whole idea of original sin. That means we all eventually, if we live long enough, come to an age of accountability. When we know that there's a God, when we know that we have sinned, when we know that we must be baptized, and at that point we must be baptized. These scriptures prove, however, that children are born innocent. So you wonder what happened to that little one that passed away. They're not in hell. This passage proves it. They're innocent. Sadly, that miscarriage, that child is with God. I say that respectfully. I know that's a tough topic. These scriptures prove, however, that children are born innocent in the eyes of God and remain so at least until they're little. So they become like these little children, and they don't know right and wrong. Now, how else can we know that the concept of original sin is false? We're going to be held accountable for our sins individually. Okay, we're going to be held accountable for our sins and division. Now, there is one major exception to this. Okay, there's one major. It is major. It's a major exception. Okay? So I tried to think of a single example, just one, where God held someone else accountable for someone else's sins. All right? That's what I was trying to think of. Okay, think of an example where God held someone else accountable for someone else's sins. And this is the one exception, and it's a big one. I will say that. But there is an explanation to it. Okay, so hear me out. So, the only one I can think of was Matthew 18, verse 6, which says this: "But if anyone causes one of these little ones who believes in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a large millstone hung around his neck and he'd be drowned in the depths of the sea." Doesn't get more serious than that. That's heavy. That's very true. But what is that referring to? What is that referring to? If you cause these little ones to stumble, what's it referring to? Our example. It's referring to our example, not causing someone else to sin, not causing little ones to sin. Okay, so in that part, if we cause someone else to stumble, then apparently, according to this, it looks like we can be held accountable under those circumstances for what they did wrong too, under that case. But that is the exception. That is the exception. Now, however, other than that example, does God hold the whole society accountable for individual sins? When somebody is murdered, does God bring all society in to stand trial for murder? When somebody steals something, does God bring the whole society in to stand before judge for that? No. God deals with us. He deals out justice and punishment individually for our individual sins. This also proves that the concept of social or group justice is also false. It's not true. Okay? The concept of social justice is not true. God deals with us individually. Colossians 3:25. Notice this. Anyone who does wrong will be repaid for his wrong. And there is no favoritism. Now Ezekiel 18:4b says, "The soul who sins is the one who will die." Ezekiel 18:17b, referring to the one who did what was right. The one who did what was right. He will not die for his father's sins, but his father will die for his own sin. 2 Corinthians 5:10, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due him for the things that he's done not in the body, whether good or bad." The truth is, we have free will. The truth is that we have the ability to choose good or evil. Every second of every day, we have the choice to choose to walk with God or rebel against Him. That's the truth. God will hold us accountable for what we have done individually. Now, here's some things that you must know. There's an old saying that says, ignorance is what? Ignorance is bliss, right? However, as a preacher of the gospel, we have a God-given duty to preach and to teach the truth. Matthew 28:20 says this. Jesus said to them, "Teach." This is part of the Great Commission. Near his final marching orders. Okay, he told me, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, and then teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. We're to teach them to obey. We're to teach each other from the Scriptures to obey everything that Christ commanded us to do. So people must not remain in ignorance. We must not remain in ignorance. 1 Timothy 4:4 says this, referring to God the Father. He wants all men, that is all people there, okay? He wants all people to be saved and to come to a what? A knowledge of the truth. To come to a knowledge of the truth. The truth is that we are in the middle of a spiritual war for the souls of people to come to God through Jesus Christ. However, before they can come to God, they must know first that they have done wrong. Now, in studying this, I found a list of 124 different specific sins from the New Testament. 124 different specific sins from the New Testament. And honestly, as I went through it, there were about six of them that were not mentioned that are in the Scriptures that I added to the list. So somewhere around 130 different types of sin that are mentioned in the New Testament. And I had a wide variety of emotions. Because as I read through them individually, my first thought, I was overwhelmed with sadness. I mean, sadness, deep sadness. And then I pondered it more and more and more, and then actually I was encouraged. So it's going to sound strange, but I'll explain it here in just a minute. But, okay, so the good news, and this is from my perspective, I'm speaking of us as a church body. I'm speaking of the church as a church body. I believe that we as a church body have not committed a little over half of the sins that are in the New Testament. Praise the Lord for that. That part's good. Okay? So a little over half we've not committed. That's very encouraging, that part. Now, also compared to this time last year, going from the list, we are down about 15 to 20 sins of where we were a year ago. That means God has brought some to repentance, and God has pruned others. It means that the Word of God is taking root. And it means that more people are getting more in step and being led by the Holy Spirit. It means we're spiritually getting more and more on the right track. That's good news. That part's good news, okay? Now, also, I did share some good news with you last week as well. I'm very encouraged with how God blesses the Vacation Bible School, with camp, with other wonderful things that God has done as well. That being said, although we are healthier, we're still not spiritually healthy yet. I believe the other half of the list are being practiced by some. Now, some of you may not be practicing any of these. Some of you may be practicing one or two. Some of you may be practicing a bunch of these. Okay? So, but I believe the other half of the list are being practiced by some, not all, but some within our church body. We need to be made aware. We need to be made aware so that we can no longer live in ignorance. We can no longer live in our lives. Here are the ones that I see that need to be repented of. Apathy is a lack of interest or concern, indifference. And again, I'm not saying everybody has all these. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying that these do exist in our congregation. Anger, the desire to punish or take vengeance. Backbiters, those who speak evil of the absent person. Slanderers, being a stumbling block. Not considering how our actions can affect the weaker brother in the faith. Being angry with one's brother. Expressing unkind thoughts or actions towards others. Bitterness. Acidity, sarcasm, unloving attitudes. Burying one's talents. Not making wise use of what God has entrusted us with. Calling one's brother a fool. Ridiculing or speaking divisively to another. Complaining. Discontentment, continual dissatisfaction, contentious, quarreling, hard to get along with, corrupt communications, unprofitable language, covenant breakers, those who break a solemn vow between two parties, cowardice, that is a lack of courage, a lack of bravery, craftiness, that is cunningness, deceptiveness, trickery, debate, contentious behavior, a quarrel or argument. Deceit, deception, falsehood. Denying Christ, to neglect or refuse the saving grace of Jesus Christ, to be ashamed to confess his name. Desiring the praise of men, doing things that gain the praise or admiration of others. Despiteful, to be insulting or to mistreat another. Dishonesty, deliberately telling untruths. Lack of openness. Division. Schisms, forming of parties within a group. Eating the bread or drinking the Lord's Supper unworthily. Partaking of the communion emblems while living in deliberate, intentional, unrepented sins. Evil thoughts, worthless, depraved, or injurious thoughts or attitudes. Fearful, that is faithless. Foolishness, without reason. Trifling, giving false witness, falsely accusing someone. Giving offense, causing someone to fall spiritually by our own ungodly example. Gossip, bearing bad news about someone behind their back out of a bad heart. Guile, deceit, cunning. Haters of God, contrary or hateful to God. Hatred, that is intense dislike or ill will. Having having evil treasures in the heart, the thoughts of affections of being evil, having pleasure in them that do things that are worthy of death, enjoying the company of the wicked, hearing the sayings of Christ, but deliberately not following them. Idle words that are of no value, that are of vain language. Idolatry, the love or devotion for a person or a thing that exceeds the love of God. First. Implacable, refusing to be appeased, relentless. Inventors of evil things, inventing evil to try to get their way. Knowing to do what is good, but not doing what is good. Not living up to our knowledge of right and wrong. Lovers of self, loving another person more than Jesus. Lying, that is intentionally telling untruths. Maliciousness, evil intentions to injure others. Spite, ill will, prompted by hatred. Malignity, that is being harmful or dangerous of bad character. Mockery, that is laughing, scoffing, or despising. Murmuring is grumbling or secretly complaining. Pride, sense of superiority, focused only on themselves. Railing, slander, abusive language. Seditions, stirring up opposition against authority. Self-will, not being willing to reason or to listen to reason. Arrogant. Speaking evil of dignitaries. Speaking evil of those who should be honored. Stiff-necked and uncircumcised in the hearts and ears. Obstinate, difficult to lead or teach. Strife, quarreling, seeking for superiority. Striker, one who is quarrelsome, ready to fight. Unbelief, that is disbelief, lack of faith, lack of obedience. Unforgiving heart, not willing to forgive. Unmerciful, mercy less. Variance, that is strife and quarreling. Whisperers, those who secretly spread false or slanderous information. Wickedness, sinful, evil practice. Sowing discord, that is spreading lies. They are only interested in getting their own self-interest. They usually target leaders. Their goal is to create distrust, division, arguments, conflict. In the scripture, those who sow discord are very closely equated to those who commit murder. Romans 16:17-18 says this, I urge you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause divisions and put obstacles in your way that are contrary to the teaching that you have learned. Keep away from them. For such people are not serving the Lord Jesus Christ, but their own interests. A heart that devises wicked schemes, wicked, evil plots, are mentioned also among the seven things that God zealously hates in the book of Proverbs. Without natural affection, without normal feelings of fondness, hard heart, and wrath, enraged, sinful behavior. What are the consequences of those unrepentant sins? Romans 6:23 says this, for the wages of sin is death. I'm going to say that again. For the wages of sin is death, eternal separation from God. Hell is a real place. Galatians 6:7-8. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. The one who sows to please the flesh will reap destruction. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Isaiah 59:2. But your iniquities have separated you from God. Your sins have hidden his face from you, so that he will not hear. Revelation 21:8. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. The Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 6 verses 1 through 4 says this. What shall we say then? Shall we go on... Let's go back this up. He's speaking to those that are immersed in Christ. He's not speaking to unbelievers here. That's an extremely important point. If they don't know Jesus, we love them, we try to reach them for Jesus, we try to get them to come to know Jesus as Lord. He is speaking to the church. That's who the Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul is speaking to here in the book of Romans. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning that grace may increase? By no means. Exclamation point. By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We therefore were buried with him through baptism in his death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. A new life. The old man's got to be dead. The old woman's got to be dead. We don't live that way anymore. We're to live by the Holy Spirit. We've repented of those sins. We've been immersed. And we need brothers and sisters in Christ to frankly get in our face and to hold us accountable. That's what we need. To say, look, brother, I love you, but you're wrong. Or sister, I love you, but you're wrong. And you're living in sin, and if you don't repent, you're going to go to hell. Yeah. That's what Scripture says. You must repent. All of us. Look, this stuff applies to me too as far as, you know, sin. Everybody has sinned, right? Nobody's perfect. But thankfully, there are brothers in Christ that will get in my face and say, I love you, but you're wrong. And thankfully because of that, and frankly because I've got a wonderful wife, I love you, Denise. I love you greatly. Between my brothers in Christ and my wife, spiritually, they help me get me back on the right track every single time. And I'm very thankful. I'm very thankful for both of those influences. But here's the thing. Brothers and sisters, we cannot remain in sin. We cannot. We must not. Or we will be lost. What is the remedy? Remember, we're to live a new life led by the Holy Spirit under the authority of the Word of God and most importantly, under the Lordship of our Lord Jesus Christ. If you love me, you will obey my commands. That's what Jesus said. What must we do to be saved? The Roman jailer asked this very question, Acts chapter 16 and verse 30. What must we do to be saved? Now, there's just been an earthquake. Maybe we need an earthquake. Now, if that happened right now, that would be pretty incredible. Okay? I have seen an earthquake a couple times. Maybe we need an earthquake. Maybe we need an earthquake to wake us out of our spiritual wickedness. Maybe that's what we need. Maybe we need an earthquake. Maybe we need to see God's hand move. Maybe we need to see, like we studied in Sunday school, where God opens up the earth and swallows those who complain continually, and they die right there. And interestingly enough, it shocks me. The very next day, they'll complain again. How does that happen? How does it happen? These things cannot be any more serious. We're talking eternity. Where we spend eternity. We need to live for Jesus now. What must we do to be saved? The Roman jailer asked this very question in Acts 16 and verse 30. He then brought them out and asked, sirs, what must we do to be saved? What must I do to be saved? Verse 31. They replied, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in the house. At that hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds. And then it says, and then immediately, he and all his family were baptized. Didn't delay. They knew, hey, I need Jesus as Lord. I've sinned, and I need to repent of it, I need to walk with God, I need to be baptized. It was immediate. Acts chapter 2, the Apostle Peter has just preached a message on the Lord Jesus to all the people. This is Acts chapter 2, verse 36. He says, therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Lord is commander. Is Jesus Lord for each of us? He must be. He must be the commander. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ, Christ being Savior. When the people, and by the way, he's not going to be Savior if he's not Lord first. We can't continue to deliberately live in deliberate, intentional, unrepentant sin and think that we're going to be saved. That's not how it works. That's not consistent with the Scripture. He must be Lord. We must repent of our sins, turn away from our sins. Okay? God made this Jesus whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. 237, when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart, they were convicted. How I wish that we would be convicted today. What do you have to do? You preach and you preach and you preach and you preach. What do you got to do? You pray. Holy Spirit, convict. Please. Word of God, speak. Please. What do we have to do to stop living in sin? It's got to stop. In Jesus' name, it has got to stop for this church to be healthy, spiritually healthy. It must stop. Peter replied, repent and turn away. Repent. That is, turn away from your sins and turn to God and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Forgive, make Jesus Lord, the forgiveness of your sins. Your sins are washed away. You receive the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. So you're no longer a spiritual wimp going around like, I just can't help it. I just can't help it. Yes, you can. The Holy Spirit can stop you. The Word of God can stop you. Brothers and sisters in Christ that want to hold you accountable can stop you. Or help to stop you, anyway. We need to get back within the will of God. So we must believe in Jesus Christ. We must repent of our sins, turn away from our sins, and be baptized in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit. Romans 8, 13 and 14 says this, for if you live, and this is speaking to all of us individually, all of us, if you live according to the flesh, you will die. Spiritual death. If you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit, that is by the Holy Spirit of God, you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. Because those that are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. Not those who just claim it. It's not just those who come to church. No. It's those that are led by the Holy Spirit of God. Those are the children of God. And so I ask you this morning, in love, are you led by the Holy Spirit of God? Or are you led by the devil? One or the other, there's no middle ground. People try to tell there's middle ground, there's no middle ground. We're either led by God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, or we're led by the devil. And it's really, truly just that simple. Romans 6:11. In the same way, get this, count yourselves what? Dead to sin. Count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Do you count yourself dead to sin? I hope so. I pray so. Live by the Holy Spirit. Revelation 2:10. Be faithful even unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. Do you see once and done there? Do you see, I went to church camp and I got baptized and I live like a pagan, I'm going to go to heaven? There? No. Not there. Not there. Revelation 2:10. Be faithful even unto death. What does that mean? Our whole life, the best we can, we need to be walking with the Lord Jesus Christ and being led by the Holy Spirit. And we mess up, we ask God for forgiveness. We repent immediately. And we get back on track with Jesus. And we live by the Holy Spirit of God. Be faithful even unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, no longer. No longer let sin be your master. Believe in Jesus, repent of your sins, be baptized, and have your sins washed away. And live by the Holy Spirit. And then, will be with Jesus forever in heaven. This morning, if you have a decision to make for Jesus Christ, please come forward and we sing our invitations. We love you. Thank you all very much for being here today. You know, I think if we're honest with ourselves, there are certain areas of our individual lives and hearts where we had to put an extra guard. I know those areas for me. Denise knows those areas for me. There are very close brothers in Christ that know those areas for me. Here's the thing. You may have something that is a tougher struggle for you. I ask in Jesus' name that you find, if you're a brother in Christ and you're married, talk to your wife. If you're not married, talk to another brother in Christ that'll hold you accountable. Brothers need brothers. Sisters need sisters. And say, hey, I'm more susceptible to this or that. Will you please help hold me accountable so I can walk closer to Jesus? I believe most everybody in this room would be willing to do that for each other. Please do that to help keep each other on the right track. I'm going to ask Matt if he would have a closing prayer for us.
Father in heaven, you are the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. We thank you for the bread you've given us today. We thank you for the message that's been brought to us, that we may search our hearts and search our minds, protect them. Remember to follow in your word this week, to follow the Spirit, not the flesh. I pray that you help us all humble ourselves and repent. Also, we seek out brothers and sisters in Christ that need our help. Guide us. Please forgive us. We just thank you for this day. In Jesus' name I pray.